Welcome to Church of the Four Corners. So glad you're here with us this morning. We're going to take a few moments and we're just going to worship our Lord. We're going to exalt His name today. compares to this love that you have given us, God. So we pursue you this morning.
Is who he says that he is, and we trust him to take care of us. And so we're going to sing this, we're going to wait on him. So we should open your heart and just say, God, I trust you in this moment. God, I'm going to wait on you and believe that you are who you say that you are in my life. So let's do that. As we continue the rest of this time together, let's just open our hearts to him.
My eyes.
I have
say high. Your glory that cannot be unseen. I am changed. I am changed. Your changing state as I look upon you, Lord. Presence in this place this morning. God, that we can, no matter what we come in here with, Lord God, that we can just lay it aside and for a few moments just look to you. That we can look to you and know, God, that you love us, that you care for us, Lord God. So we give all glory to your name. We lift you up, God. We take our eyes off ourselves, but leave them on you, Jesus. We give you praise. In your precious name, we say, amen, amen. You may have a seat.
Well, welcome to church this morning. Right off the top, before I get into my announcements, I just wanted to mention, I'm not sure if some of you heard, but late last night, there was a shooting in Orlando at a club. Crazy. Over 300 people were there, and I guess now the count is 50 people who are now killed. And so I believe in times of great distress and whenever things happen, it's our job as believers and it's our job as the church to lift it up in prayer. God says that whenever we are made weak, that he is made strong. And so if you could, just make a little space and let's just cry out to God for peace and comfort to be given to those people who are there. God, right now, I just thank you. I just pray right now for the situation that's happening in Orlando. We pray for those that have been devastated by the recent events down there. I thank you that you will just give peace and give comfort to the families of those who were affected, for the people who might have witnessed what happened, God. Sometimes it's so hard to understand why bad things happen, but we know that you are our comforter whenever we're in mourning. You are our strength when we are weak. And in your word says, it says that if two or more are gathered, that there you will be. And we come as a body, as a church, asking you to have mercy, God, for the paramedics, for the police who are having to handle the scene, God. Just give them wisdom beyond your years, their years. Just help them. Give them a peace like no other and a comfort. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, if you are a first-time guest this morning here at church, my name is Tanya, I'm the environments pastor here. I oversee our kids department and all of our ministries. And let me tell you, you just walked into one of the most amazing churches. You might have gotten greeted by a smiling face walking through a door, one of our crew members. You might have gotten a friendly wave out in the parking lot. Maybe you got checked in by the world's friendliest kids check-in team or by a small group leader at their door. But whatever it is, I hope that you were welcomed. And whenever you came in, you received a Connect card. On that Connect card, there's a top portion. Just if you wouldn't mind filling out that information and checking the little blue box that says, this is my first time here. We'd love to just send you an email, say thanks for coming. You can do a couple of things with that card. You can go ahead and put it in the bucket at the end of service in the offering, or you can take it out to our VIP table out there, and in exchange, they'll give you a lovely mug just to say thanks for coming today. But man, we have got a great crew here. Can we give it up for the crew that serves every single Sunday, consistently, all the time, with smiling faces? It's amazing. If you are not a part of the crew, you need to get involved. It's a place where you'll be able to find community. There's someone that knows your name when you walk in the door, and it'll change your life. So if you're not a part of a crew, you need to get plugged in. We have a growth track in the middle of July where you can get plugged in that way. Go to the VIP table to learn more about that. Another great thing today is it's Promotion Sunday for our students and little ones. So what that means is we had some big five-year-olds who are moving on to kindergarten, and I saw some mamas with some little tears in their eyes, but they're growing up and they are moving up by going down to the blue room. So there was that change this morning, and it was awesome. I was going through the hall and I saw some of the small group leaders, and they were saying, oh, they're not in our group anymore. Like, it's such a so cool to see, because our small group leaders take such ownership of the kids because they just love them so much. Also, we have our fifth graders who are now going into sixth grade. They're gonna have the opportunity to join a small group tonight for their first ever youth small group service. So if your kiddo is not involved in a small group, see Connor Jones or go on our website and you can sign up for that there. So a lot of great things happening today. It's gonna be a great morning. We have Connor Jones coming to give the word. It's gonna be great, all about trusting God. You're gonna be really blessed by it. But before we do that, if we could stand to our feet and say hello. Oh man, that was a slow stand today. Some people have been working in their yard a little bit this morning. Go ahead, turn to someone, say, you're looking good, I'm glad you're here.
Well, hey, what's up, Church of the Four Corners? We are on location here at Holy Trinity Church in Cantemir, Moldova, and it has been such an incredible past few days getting a chance to see the cities of Chisinau and also spending the day with Pastor Boris and experiencing the incredible ministry that they have going on in this church, and also seeing how we get to play a part in the future of what God is going to do to redeem this area. So we have so many exciting things happening in the church right now. Specifically, number one, starting today begins our summer small group semester. For those of you who haven't had the opportunity to join a group yet, why not? Join a group, jump in. It's so simple, simply by going to coftfc.com/groups, or you can click on the groups thumbnail at the homepage. You can see all of the different groups we have available, groups that meet on different times, during different days, different types of group. We believe at our church that we are better together than we are apart, so please take advantage of that. Secondly, on Saturday, June 25th, we have Project Shine. This starts at 7 a.m. and Project Shine is an opportunity for us as a church to come alongside of the independent school district and to be a support for them. We believe that the church is never more like Jesus than when we serve those around us and show them love. And one of the opportunities and ways for us to do this is by partnering with Glendale Elementary. And this is a chance for us to go and paint hallways, paint classrooms, participate in beautification processes, and really bless the educators and all of those who pour into our children on a daily basis. So we want to highly encourage you to be a part. The third thing that we have happening is our child dedications. These will take place on Sunday, June 26th. So for those of you who have recently had children or haven't had the opportunity to have your children dedicated, we would love for you to be a part of this special day. It's an opportunity for us to pray over the children, to pray over the parents, and for the church to come alongside of those parents and to say, we're going to help co-labor in parenting with you. It's a powerful experience that you're not going to want to miss. You can sign up for our child dedication simply by putting child dedication anywhere on your Connect card, and we'll get in contact with you with all of the information and next steps that you need. So we're in for a treat today. We're beginning a brand new series entitled Distant God, and up to bring a powerful word is one of our pastors, Connor Jones. Let's make him feel welcome this morning.
Good morning. Good morning, guys. My name is Connor, as he said. Man, isn't it amazing technology? Like, our pastor just gave us our church news like halfway around the world. That's amazing, isn't it? So cool. Man, how about worship? Like, I'm still feeling it a little bit. I'm trying to shake it out a little bit. That was really good. I am the youth pastor here at Church of the Four Corners, and I'm so glad that you're here with us this morning, starting a new series entitled Distant God, and it's going to be really awesome. I think it's a great message for our church, and I want to give you a warning right off the bat. We don't give warnings for every series we do, but this is a series that we're going to give a bit of a warning. For the next 3 weeks, we are going to be exploring and looking at some topics that are kind of difficult. They're not super easy. They're a little uncomfortable. Everything we're going to be talking about for the next 3 weeks revolves around is when God seems far away in our lives. When God doesn't make sense. And we're left with this question, where was God? Where was God? And some of you guys in the room, you probably felt that a little bit when I said that because you've experienced an extreme change happened in your life that you weren't expecting. You've lost somebody before, and it's not easy. And honestly, some of us for the next 3 weeks, we're not going to love what we're talking about because there aren't going to be easy answers. We're not handling something that's really just fun and friendly exactly. It's going to be a little difficult. But I believe as a church, we have to acknowledge the reality of life. Sometimes it's not hilarious. Sometimes it's not something we can tweet about. Sometimes it's not always practical. Sometimes life is just hard. And we know that. We've experienced that. And so with that being said, I want to encourage you to invite your friends. I know I probably made you feel like you don't want to be in this room right now, but seriously, invite your friends. If you know someone who's gone through a really difficult time, maybe they've left the church, maybe they've just kind of given up on God, this is a great message for them. If you know somebody who's going through a hard time right now, this is going to be a great teaching that they need to hear in the next 2 weeks as well. So share it online. Invite them here in person. Show them some love and make sure they're here because it's going to be great. We're going to hop in today to our specific message of distant God. And so I'm going to start with some questions. How many of you guys hate waiting? Yes, there we go. I was like, some of you guys like waiting? If you've ever heard me speak, I somehow work in like my hatred for waiting in lines and stuff like that every sermon, so this is no different. How many of you guys hate waiting on water to boil? Not fun. Not cool at all. How many of you guys hate waiting for the light to turn green? Help me, Jesus. Like when the light's red for too long? No. I'm about to flip my car over. Okay. How many of you guys hate waiting on airplanes in airports? I just avoid airplanes. Just road trip everywhere. How many of you guys hate waiting for the AC to cool your house? It's getting hot. Not fun. How many of you guys hate waiting on your spouse? Don't raise your hand. That was a joke. I'm going to save your marriage right now. Don't do that. I saw some people raise their hands. I'm going to pray for you.
This week, we are going to talk about something that has to do with waiting when it comes to God. We're going to be talking about when God seems late to the party, when God seems late in our lives. We're waiting for him, we're watching the clock, we're hoping, we're praying that he'll show up. And right now, some of us in the room, we're waiting. Some of us online, you're waiting right now on God to show up. And maybe you've begun to start asking this question. Some of us subconsciously are asking this question, why doesn't God do something about it? I don't know what your it is. For me and my family right now, we have a baby on the way, and we're looking for a house, and it's stressful. Like, I don't know a lot about babies, but they need a place to live, and I don't have enough room right now. And so it's stressful, it's hard. Maybe for you, it's something completely different. Maybe it's a financial challenge in your life. Maybe you have a job need that you're waiting on the Lord for. Maybe you have a medical issue that you just keep praying over and praying over. It might be a relationship. But let's just be real for a moment this morning. How many of you guys would just say in one form or another, maybe you didn't say it exactly this way, maybe you've subconsciously gone to this place, but you ask the question, why doesn't God do something about it? Like, why doesn't he do something about this situation? And the reality is that everybody here in this room and online, we're going to experience seasons where we're waiting on God. We know God could do something about our situation. We've seen him do something in other people's lives, but he is not doing anything right now. And so we end up waiting. And that season's awkward, and it's frustrating, and it's hard. I know a family that's been waiting to conceive a child, and they're praying, and they're waiting, and they're trying. And when you look at all the unwanted pregnancies in the world, your mind starts to wander and go to that place like, we actually want a baby. Why are we waiting right now? Maybe you're waiting for a job. And you're ready to get into the workplace. You're ready to hit it hard and go for it. And you're looking for jobs and you're looking for jobs and it's just not happening. Maybe you're waiting for a miracle in a relationship or a house to sell. You're waiting for a loved one to come to Christ. Maybe you're waiting for physical healing in your body, a miracle. It can't happen unless God does it. You're waiting. Where is God right now? Why doesn't he do something about it? I want to give you a key thought for today that's kind of the overarching thought for all day long that you can hold on to, and that's this: with God, a waiting season is never a wasted season. I'll say it again. With God, a waiting season, it's never a wasted season. And we're going to look at this today in a story, a powerful story in the Gospel of John, chapter 11, the story of two sisters and their brother, Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. And we've touched on this before. We actually talked about it in our Keyholders series. You can watch that online if you want. We talked about how God wants to resurrect our belief, and we use this story. But if you maybe didn't grow up in church, not super familiar with the Bible, you might not know that Mary and Martha were fairly close to Jesus. This story isn't the only story where they've encountered him. Actually, in Luke, there's a story where Jesus comes over to their house for dinner. And Mary and Martha are very different people. It's kind of funny. So Martha's like rushing around and she's freaking out and trying to fix the house up and do the dishes. And Jesus is here and she's like going crazy. And then Mary's kind of the opposite. She's kind of leaned back. She's not doing much. She's hanging out with Jesus. And Martha's like, why are you not doing anything? Jesus, tell her to get started. Like, I'm trying to serve you. And some of us are like Martha, we're kind of type A and a little bit confrontational, and we want to get things done and done right. And some of us are like Mary, and we're kind of leaned back, maybe introverted, you know, we just like to kind of hang out. And the point is, though, is that these women were so close to Jesus that he came over and had fried chicken, you know, or whatever they had, and they had a connection. And so when their brother Lazarus falls sick, they assume what is logical, that we're close with Jesus. He's been doing this in his ministry, healing random people. Surely he will come and he'll help out our brother Lazarus. He's going to do the same for us that he's doing for other people. But we're going to find is that God doesn't always make sense to us. John 11, verse 1 and verse 3, it says, now a man named Lazarus was sick. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. And it goes on to say that he was their brother. And so the sisters sent word to Jesus, "Lord, the one you love is sick." Catch the intimacy. They don't even say Lazarus' name. When they send the messenger, they just say, "Lord, the one you love is sick." Because they're so close to Jesus, they assume he'll understand who they're talking about. That's close, right? Like, your best bud is sick. Your best friend, he's not feeling great. Like, that's basically what they're doing right now. And so they send this out, and they're hoping for Jesus to show up. They know he heals people all the time, and so they wait. And Jesus doesn't show up. And they wait another day, and they're probably like, you know, he'll be here, he'll be here, he'll show up. They're close to him. Is that him? I think that's just the mailman. Okay, he'll show up, he'll be here, he'll be here. Next night comes, and they're probably like, I can't believe it. I don't know where he's at. He's taking his time, but he knows what's going on. He'll show up the next day. He'll be here. He'll be here. And like us, they might have started thinking to themselves over time as Jesus took longer and longer, you know, I'm a good person. I serve you, God. I try to do my best. Maybe some of you have said these things before. And I listen to Christian radio, God, like the same 7 songs over and over again. That's how much I love you. I give money to fake Santas outside of malls. I'm charitable. I've tweeted a Bible verse on Twitter before. Okay, I'm being bold for my faith. You feel like you're doing everything, man. I serve in the church, God. Don't you know? Like, every Sunday, I'm serving. I'm doing things. I serve in kids, God. Are you serious right now? Like, where are you at? And yet Jesus doesn't show up. With God, a waiting season is never a wasted season. And so for those of you right now who are waiting, or maybe you will be waiting in the future, I want to give you 2 things to build your faith in the waiting, to build your faith in the middle of the waiting season. The first thing is this. Remember this. God's delays are not necessarily God's denials. In other words, just because God hasn't done it doesn't mean he won't do it. Just because God hasn't answered that prayer that you've been praying doesn't mean that he's never going to answer that prayer. In fact, in verse 4, we see that Jesus is hearing the longing of Mary and Martha's heart. He's hearing the heart of their prayer. And it says, when he heard this, that their brother was sick, Lazarus, Jesus said, "This sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it." In other words, Jesus is saying, I know what's going on, and I'm in complete control right now. And when you get to the end of this storm, when you get to the end of this waiting season, you're going to see that I had a plan. You're going to see me be glorified through the thing that you never wanted to happen in your life. Remember, God's delays, they're not always denials. And I would argue that sometimes God actually places these delays in our lives. God actually puts these divine delays in our lives. God wants to do the thing that you want, but he's not going to do it now, because he has a different purpose in mind. And I believe many times God wants to do something inside of us before he does something for us, because he has a purpose. It's kind of like when you have kids and they want something and you're not going to give it to them right now, because the lesson they're going to learn from not having it is more important. God wants to do something in us before he does something for us. And I know in my life, I've experienced this in the waiting, that God does something inside of me that's very important and miraculous, things that I don't naturally have inside of me. In the waiting, he teaches me to rely on him, to call on his name. He teaches me to have patience, which we've gone over. I don't have. He teaches me to walk in faith and not by sight. I can't see what's on the other side. He teaches me to believe that his ways are higher than my ways. I've got to trust him. I don't know exactly what's going on. He teaches me that when I'm weak, he's strong. He's made perfect in my weakness. And sometimes he wants to do something inside of you before he does something for you and for your situation. He wants to do something inside of you before he does something through you. Maybe you're jumping at the bit. You're ready to go, but God has a plan to do something in you first before he does something through you. Mary and Martha, they're waiting and they're believing. And we're going to find that with God, this waiting season isn't a wasted season. So time goes by, and Jesus is still not there. He still hasn't arrived. Lazarus is really, really sick, and they know this. And you've got to imagine, just like it would with us, that their prayers are a little harder to say. The sickness is weighing on them, weighing on their faith that Jesus will actually show up. And then Lazarus breathes his last breath and dies. Where was God? Jesus is out healing everybody and their brother. He's associating with Roman soldiers. He's hanging out with Samaritans, but not my brother, not the one he loves, not his close friend. What do we do when God seems distant? Well, a long time later, way long later, Jesus finally shows up. By the time he gets there, it's insultingly rude. People have brought food to the family. Lazarus has been wrapped and put in the tomb. He's been there for a day and another day and another day and another. And then Jesus shows up. And it almost feels personal, you've got to imagine, right? Like, Jesus, not only did he not heal Lazarus, but he didn't show up for the funeral, the graveside, to comfort the family, and now he's here. Verse 17 says, on his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. It's important we stop here. First of all, if you read ahead, you're going to notice that Lazarus being in the tomb for 4 days has started to stink. Okay? The natural process has begun. He's been in a tomb. But the other real important thing to note for 4 days is that back in this time, in this age, people believed in a superstition that said that if you died for the next 3 days, your spirit kind of hovered over your body. And they believed that it was kind of searching, and if the stars aligned, if you prayed right, if you did the right thing, you could hope maybe for a miracle that the spirit would come back and they would come back from the dead. But on day 4, no. It's all done. No chance. They're coming back. And so that's where we're at. We're on day 4. No hope. Jesus, you failed. You let us down. It's over. It's the end. I don't get this. I don't understand why you're here right now. Let me tell you, if you have not experienced that moment yet, you will. What do you do in that moment? You could have done it, Jesus. You've done it for other people. You didn't show up. Where are you right now? In verse 20, we read this. When Martha got word that Jesus was coming, she went to meet him. And this fits Martha's personality, right? Kind of confrontational, type A. She's going to go talk to Jesus. Like, we have some words to say. But true to Mary, Mary stays in the house. She just can't, make that trek right now to meet Jesus. She's probably broken. And Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if only you would have been here, my brother would not have died. And you can hear that accusing tone. If only you would have been here. It's almost as if she's saying, you remember that one time where you came to my house and had dinner? You showed up there on time. Why aren't you here right now? Where are you? Where were you when my brother was dying? But the beautiful thing, and I love this, is verse 22, because I feel like I live in this spot. After the accusation, she says, but even now, I know that God will give you whatever you ask. God, where were you? You could have done this. You didn't show up. You didn't do it, but I trust you. I don't know how many of you guys have experienced divorce. Maybe your parents are divorced, or maybe you've experienced the hard trials of divorce in your own life and you have children, but it is so hard on a child. And I remember when I was 10 and my parents got divorced, I understood why they were getting divorced. They fought a ton, and this was them separating from those fights. But at the same time, at 10 years old, I knew even then that marriage was forever. And so I cried and I prayed, and it was just so hard for me and my brothers. And I honestly just, like lots of kids, wanted everything to be back to normal. And I didn't have words for it at the time, but I was screaming inside, why is this happening? Why did you bring my parents together to have us only to have them fall apart? Where are you, God? And like millions of other children with divorced parents, I didn't have a happy Disney ending. They didn't come back together and get remarried. It's just what it was. It's what it is. I remember dozens of nights as a kid bargaining with God. I go to church. I try. They tried to follow love. I don't understand what's going on. But somehow, even at 10, I still trusted God. I still believe that he knew what was best. Jesus, if you would have been here, this wouldn't have happened. But I know that even now, God will give you whatever you ask. I think God looks down on us in those moments where we're confused and we're angry and we're speaking to him in that way. And I think it's like kids who don't like what their father just told them. We get angry, we slam some doors, but at the end of the day, we still love our dad. And I believe God is just looking down on us. He's saying, you don't understand right now. You don't see the whole picture, but I love you. Keep trusting me. Keep following me. And this is where some of us are at right now. We're waiting and it's not happening. Your financial situation doesn't change even though you're working as hard as you can. You're working on your marriage, and the other person just keeps getting more bitter, and you're asking God, why? Why is this happening? You're praying for a miracle that you know God can do, but for some reason he's not doing it. And you just feel this distance between God and your expectations. I worship you. I believe in you. I trust in you. I follow you. Why are you not doing what I'm asking? Why are you not meeting my expectations right now, God? And it brings us to our second thing we need to remember in the waiting season, which is this. If God always met your expectations, he'd never have the chance to exceed them. Let that sink in for a second. I'll explain it like this. Where we left off, Lazarus was dead. Dead. Like 4 days dead, no hope. And then just below this verse, in verse 23, Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Verse 22, no hope. Verse 23, hope. If God always met our expectations, he would never have a chance to exceed them. Everything can change in a moment with Jesus. And so Jesus says, your brother will rise again. And Martha responds, and she says, yeah, he'll rise when everyone else rises at the end of time, at the last day. I get it. Martha clearly believed that God one day is going to come and gather his children to be with him at the end of time. And I get it. Like, that's comforting, I guess. I wish you would have been here. But in an amazing way, as he usually does, Jesus turns everything on its head. Jesus tells her, I am the resurrection and the life. Anyone who believes in me will live even after dying. Everyone who lives in me and believes in me will never, ever die. Do you believe this, Martha? You see, Jesus was right when he said he would be glorified in this. In a grand illustration of his power, Jesus is saying, you thought the resurrection was an event, but it's not so much an event as it is a person. You see, I am the resurrection and the life. Death no longer has the final say when you're with me. Whenever you put your faith in me, though your body dies, you will never die with me. If God always met your expectations, he would never have a chance to exceed them. Mary and Martha were expecting healing, but we're going to see Jesus planned for a resurrection. What they wanted was good, but what God had planned was far, far better. And there are those of us in the room right now, and we're hoping and we're praying for something, and you need to know this morning that if you got that thing, it would not be as good as what God has planned for you, has in store for you. There may be a man or a woman in your life right now, and you're like, God, this is the one. I'm going to marry him. You're telling people, we're getting married. We're getting hitched. But if you only knew the spouse that you will actually meet 3 years from now, you would be saying, thank you, Jesus, for not letting us get married, because this one is so much better, and this one is an upgrade to the last one, and they love me so much, and he cares for me so much, and she's so much better. Some of us, the people who are laughing, know what's going on, okay? We've been down that road. Maybe you're waiting for this job, and you're just stressing over it, and you're stressing over it, and you're telling God, this is the one. And then someone you know gets the promotion. Someone you know gets the job, and you're like, what is going on? But if you only would have known that 9 months later, God was going to give you the job of your dreams, that God was going to exceed your expectations, if he would have given you that job, he would have never been able to exceed them. And so they pray for a healing, and they pray for a healing, and Jesus says, no. I'm actually going to raise this one from the dead. Because I want you to know that I'm the resurrection and the life. That though one dies physically, they don't die spiritually when they're connected to me. What you expected was not what I had planned. And so they're standing outside Lazarus' tomb, and Jesus tells them to roll away the stone. And John 11:43 says, Jesus shouted, Lazarus, come out. You might wonder, why'd he shout? It's because Lazarus is dead. Dead people don't hear very well. And so the dead man came out, it says. And his hands and feet were bound in grave clothes, his face wrapped in a head cloth. And Jesus told them, unwrap him and let him go. God didn't give them what they expected. He exceeded their expectations. And I want you to know, God's delays, they're not always denials. They're not necessarily a denial in your life. Just because you're not married right now doesn't mean you'll never be married. Just because your marriage isn't good right now doesn't mean that God's not going to create a miracle where you're going to experience intimacy with your spouse that you never dreamed was possible. Just because your child isn't serving God right now doesn't mean that down the line they're not going to be serving God in their workplace or serving God overseas as a missionary. Just because you don't see it right now, it does not mean that God's not going to bring it about in your life. And you might wake up, and I hope you do, and realize one day that the scene of your greatest disappointment was the setting for God's greatest miracle in your life. The thing you never, ever wanted to happen became the thing that God used to reveal his goodness and his plans for you beyond your greatest expectations. I have multiple family members that I'm praying for right now to come to know Jesus. Some of them I've been praying over for years when I remember, honestly, because it gets hard. Waiting is hard. Days turn into weeks. Weeks turn into months. Months turn into years. And before you know it, you are in the middle of a waiting season. And I'm doing the only thing I know how to do. I'm just trying to stay faithful and pray as much as I can and believe that God's going to do a miracle beyond me. I know I can't force somebody to make that choice, that the Spirit has to draw them. And I'm not in control in this situation. I'm just believing for a miracle. And honestly, there's no guarantee. No guarantee that any of those family members will come to know Jesus. Just like there's no guarantee that you're going to get that house with the granite countertops. Just like there's no guarantee that you're always going to have a higher paying job. Just like there's no guarantee that your spouse is always going to do the right thing. Just like there's no guarantee that this year is going to be better than last year is going to be better than last year. That's just a distorted version of Christianity that some of us in America have clung to, but it's not accurate. It's just not true. Sometimes you're in a waiting season and there's nothing that can be guaranteed except for the fact that Jesus will be glorified in your situation. Because Jesus is always glorified in his plans. He's always glorified in his plans. And I'm believing for spiritual breakthrough in my family. I still am. I'm still trying to hold strong, but no matter what happens in the waiting, no matter what happens after the waiting, I'm still going to trust that God is good. And you know what? If I don't understand, I'll probably tell him about it. I believe that's biblical. I believe if you open up Psalms or you read about David, there's an honesty there. I believe God wants an honest relationship. Sometimes we don't know what's going on. That's okay. Sometimes we're frustrated about what's going on. That's okay. So for those of you in the that are in a waiting season right now, I just pray that God would open your hearts, that he would just begin to maybe break some hard hearts and just allow you to embrace his love and who he is. I just pray right now he would reveal to you that with him, a waiting season is never wasted. That his delays, they're not always denials. That God might want to just do something inside of you, inside of your family, inside of your workplace before he does something for your situation. And that if he always met your expectations, which seem to always be shorter than what God has planned, he would never have the opportunity to exceed them. Romans 8:28 says this, and we know that in all things, the good things and the bad things in our lives, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. So in the waiting, we choose to trust you, God. In the waiting, we choose to believe that you are a good God. Pray with me this morning. Father, we just worship you right now. We thank you, Lord, for your love. And sometimes we don't understand what's going on. Life is honestly really hard sometimes. And for whatever reason, you've chosen to not give us an infinite perspective. You've chosen to just let us see what we can see. And we don't know all of your plans. And sometimes it's really, really hard to get why you're taking us in a certain direction, why you're allowing certain things to happen in our lives. Lord, we're just honest right now. Sometimes we don't get it. Sometimes we're frustrated. God, I just pray that you would teach us to trust you anyways. I pray that you would teach us to understand that your plans and your ways, they're higher than our ways, that you see what we can't see, that you're greater than us, and that you're good, you're good God. And you're bringing everything according to your plan to glorify you. This morning I'm going to give an opportunity for you to respond. And it's going to be really simple. There's just three that I think are really clear responses this morning. And the first one is this. Maybe you're in the room right now and you would just say, I'm in a waiting season and I need some prayer, somebody to come alongside me and just believe for endurance in this waiting season, to believe that God is good in this waiting season. If that's you and you just want prayer while you're in the waiting, I want to pray for you this morning. Would you just raise your hand? Yeah, I see those all around. You can put those down. Thank you, Lord. The second is this. There's some of us in the room right now. We've experienced God not meet our expectations. And honestly, you would say this morning, I don't really see God as a good God. I don't really understand God right now, if I'm being transparent. And if that's you, I just want to pray with you this morning that God would begin to speak to your heart, show you that he's good, show you that he loves you, show you that he has a plan for you. And honestly, what's to lose? I know maybe you're frustrated at God, but what will prayer hurt? if that's you and you just want somebody to pray over your heart to see God as a good God and a loving God again, I want to pray with you this morning. Would you just raise your hand? Thank you. Yeah, you can put that down. Thank you, Lord. And then the last one is this. Maybe you would just say, I'm going through a hard time right now, and I don't know God. I don't know Jesus. And I just want to say right now, if that's you, you're in the right place this morning, and God is amazing, and he's going to walk with you through the trials. It may not turn out the way you think it should, but he is good, and he is a comforter, and he is the wisest counsel you can have in your life. And so if that's you, and you just say, I want to commit to following after Christ, I want to walk with him through this life, I want to pray for you this morning. Would you raise your hand if you'd like to commit your life to Christ this morning? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Father, we thank you so much for who you are and your goodness. Lord, I just pray right now for those who are in the waiting season. They're waiting for something, they're praying for something, and they just don't see you meeting their need right now. Lord, that you would give them endurance, that you would give them the ability to trust in you. God, that you would just give them peace that doesn't make sense, an understanding of your goodness as they continue to be faithful and pray for the outcome. Lord, we just pray you'd be with them. Lord, I pray for those in the room right now that need to know that you're a good God. Right now they can't say that. Right now they can't really believe that. But Lord, I just pray that you begin to whisper in their ear, that you begin to soften their hearts, that you begin to give them a perspective they didn't have before, that you begin to heal wounds in the name of Jesus. Lord, do what only you can do by your Spirit. Let them know your love and your grace, Father. And Jesus, I pray right now for anybody in this room who needs to come into relationship with you and follow after you. If that's you, I just want you to repeat this prayer. It's nothing magical. It's just you committing your heart to Christ. If you want to say it in other words, that's fine. If you want to say it in your heart, that's fine. But just repeat this. Father God, I thank you for your love. I thank you for your Son, Jesus, who came to die in my place, who came to take the punishment for the sin in my life. I acknowledge I'm broken. I'm imperfect. I don't understand everything in my life, but I believe that the Creator is greater than the creation, that you know more than I do, and that your plan is good, and I want to begin to follow after your plan. Lord, I put my trust in you. Help me to be obedient. I understand it's not going to be easy. I understand I'm going to make mistakes. Help me, Lord, to follow after you to the best of my abilities. Lord, to love you and to learn more about you. God, I thank you for eternal life. I thank you that because I'm putting my trust in you, I'll get to see you one day. I love you, Lord. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Thank you guys so much.
Let's give Connor a big round of applause. What a great word. Trusting God when it's hard. We've all been there. You might even be there now. Well, in just a second, we are going to worship through the giving of our offerings. And before we do, there's some giving options that come up right behind me. So while you're getting that ready, let me just go ahead and give you some next steps. Some of you this morning may have made a decision to make Jesus the Lord of your life. And if you did, that's awesome. There's no better thing that you could do. Fortunately, you walked into an amazing church this morning. So it's going to be really hard to do this on your own. But thankfully, you're here and you can get connected. So this morning, I want you to make a decision to be counted. If you made that decision this morning, you received a Connect card. And on there, if you just would indicate, today I decided to make Jesus Lord of my life. We'd love to take some next steps with you. Maybe for you, you've just kind of been walking in and you've been walking out. You've kind of been anonymous, kind of hiding in the shadows. Maybe for you, it's filling out that card, telling someone you were here. You're deciding to make your attendance here matter. Maybe for you, you want to go to the VIP table and say, I need to get hooked up in a small group. Maybe I need to sign up to be baptized, to profess my faith to everybody around me. Maybe I need to sign up for a growth track class where I can learn more about our church and how I can serve on a crew to be a part of something that's bigger than ourselves. That's coming up in the middle of July, and we'd love to have you there. No matter what step you're taking this morning, don't just walk out not doing anything. Tell yourself, I'm going to make this decision count. And when you do, you'll see that God will take you places that you've never been. In just a second, we're going to pray. But even through our prayer, whenever we have this worship time during offering, don't leave. Don't go. Stick around. Worship is a body. It's our one time whenever we come together where we can say, God, this moment is yours. My decision, it's yours. I need to seek you for just a couple more seconds. So stick around for that, and we'll be dismissed after. But let's go ahead and pray together. God, I thank you for all of these people who made the decision for you. They made a decision to follow after you. They told themselves that they can't do this on their own. They can't do this anymore on their own strength. God, I thank you for other people in the room where they just needed to take a next step. They just needed to be made known. They need to get hooked into life. They need to get hooked into this church so that they can be a part of other people who get the same God that they serve. I thank you that whatever trajectory we're on, that we just make something happen this morning, that we make a decision count. We love you. I thank some of us this morning, this may be the first time that we're giving. We want to bless you through our finances. Maybe we need to trust you with that, God. Whatever it is, just bless it and bless the giver and bless us as we have an amazing week and we can come back together next Sunday believing for great things. We love you so much. In Jesus' name, amen. Stick around and worship as we give. You can go ahead and stand.
Oh, holy is the Lord revealed before my eyes, and my burning heart can scarcely take it in. As I behold your beauty with unworthy eyes, and the only song my soul can fight to say. This morning, once again, we have prayer down front. Please don't leave this place if there's anything that you need prayer for, okay? We'll see you guys next week for week 2 of our series. Have a great day.